With internet service providers in dozens of countries around the world advertising gigabit or even faster internet service, it's awfully tempting to yell, "Shut up and take my money!" and then bathe yourself in a waterfall of dank memes. But before you spend even more of your hard-earned dollars upgrading an already too expensive internet plan, there's a lot you need to consider. First of all, how is that connection even getting to your PC or other devices? Is it going to be a bottleneck? Well, for most people, the answer to that question is by using the ISP-provided router. Now, if that happens to be in the same room, or you're lucky enough to have Ethernet in your walls, great! Any reasonably modern device, except smart TVs for some reason, should have a gigabit Ethernet port, meaning you will get the full benefit. And even if you weren't so lucky as all that, modern powerline network adapters and even Wi-Fi can handle gigabit or more. However, everything that I just said comes with some big buts. Let's start with the most common connection today, Wi-Fi. If you happened to buy yourself a premium Wi-Fi router or access point in the last 20 minutes or so, well, congratulations, one percenter. You're ready to download at gigabit speeds. Sort of, more on that later. For everyone else who grabbed a $15 USB Wi-Fi dongle and called it a day, well, I've got some bad news. Advertised Wi-Fi speeds are a pipe dream. Specifically, this kind of pipe dream. I mean, sure, with enough spatial streams, your pre-plague Wi-Fi 5 setup could hit gigabit in the real world, but between your walls, cats, and just plain old distance, you'd be lucky to get half of that, leaving the rest of your tasty megabits untouched. Now, the justification for these advertised speeds is that with multiple concurrent users all downloading at the same time, the total might add up to something approaching that number. But that also assumes that you have a bunch of people who are downloading at the same time, and that your router and your devices have implemented optional parts of the Wi-Fi spec that, spoiler alert, they often didn't. Oh, and before I spoil that too, our sponsor is
Ridge. They're celebrating their 11th anniversary right now. Why don't you join them? There might be cake. Virtual cake. In the form of savings! Head over to the link below, bring your party hat, and check out the sale.
Everything I just said about Wi-Fi applies equally to Powerline and Mocha. If you're on anything but the latest version of the tech under optimal conditions, it is unlikely that you need a gigabit pipe to keep them fed. But let's say for the sake of argument, you have overcome those problems. Let's meet potential bottleneck number two, your computer. Whether your computer looks like this, or this, or this, or this, the data that reaches your network adapter still needs to be processed and sometimes stored. Now, as long as you have a solid state drive, the storage part is probably fine. Gigabit or 1000 megabit is just 125 megabytes per second. It's not that much in the grand scheme of things. So then, why is the processing an issue? Well, you see, data hosts and internet service providers greatly prefer that the files you download are compressed. This helps them save on storage space and helps them save on bandwidth costs as your juicy memes, movies, and games come flying over the wire. The downside of all of this is that someone needs to uncompress them. That's you, which is why downloading games from Steam has turned into kind of an informal benchmark around here, because it turns out to max out a gigabit line in Steam, you need a pretty modern CPU. To max out 2.5 gig, you pretty much need a top-of-the-line gaming chip. And to even approach the limits of the 10 gig connection that we have to our on-site Steam cache, we need a $10,000 96-core Threadripper Pro. Now, as you can imagine, most people's PCs, and especially game consoles, aren't equipped with any of that stuff. I mean, even the PS5 and Xbox Series X struggle to reach full gigabit speeds for game downloads. And as for the Nintendo Switch, well, it's in a class of its own, the less advanced class, struggling to reach real-world speeds of even just 100 megabit, which was the standard on PCs, oh, I don't know, 25 years ago. Now, there are valid use cases for fat download speeds, and we will talk about those. But first, let's change gears to what most people are actually doing with their internet connection most of the time. And it isn't playing that game, it's playing other games. Now, obviously, every game's a little different, but we spent 10 minutes in Rocket League and Halo Infinite moving about 6 megabytes and 15 megabytes of data, respectively. That doesn't mean you're gonna be able to get by with a 0.25 megabit connection.
Your voice chat might not be too happy about that.
But what it does mean is that a 200 to 300 megabit connection is lots for even a full house of active gamers, especially now that Steam allows local transfers of game files. However, that doesn't mean that just any connection will do, because any gamer will tell you, once you've got enough bandwidth, latency is the real difference between pwn or be pwned, and it can be worthwhile to test drive any available local ISPs to see who nets you the lowest ping times to your favorite game servers. The same actually goes for streaming games from a service like GeForce Now or Xbox Cloud. Depending on the resolution and frame rate that you target, they call for anywhere from 10 to 45 megabit. Now, game streaming is a unique beast because even a tiny disruption can spell disaster. So while I wouldn't say you need gigabit, I would probably double or even triple the on-paper requirements just to ensure that my little sister's book report doesn't get my squad wiped out. But the same is not true of Netflix and other video streaming services, which is actually kind of funny when you consider how much 4K video streaming gets talked about in ISP marketing materials. We're talking max 50 megabit per stream, and it pre-buffers in chunks for smoother playback, kind of like your old Discman with anti-skip. So yeah, the faster your connection, the quicker you'll be able to scrub within your content since those chunks will come down so fast. But even then, there's a point of diminishing returns, and past a few hundred megabit, Netflix's own servers are unlikely to send you the data any faster. Which brings us to the third big bottleneck. For data to transfer from one place to another, well, it's gonna have to be received by you, but also sent by someone else at the same speed. And how many businesses do you know that like spending extra money on an overkill connection that most people won't benefit from? That's right, guys. The vast majority of the services that you use are gonna be throttled on their side rather than on yours. Well, okay, Linus, but I'm a turbo-tabbing, browsing social media consumption machine. I'm gonna use all the sites at once. Neat. Do you want the bad news first? Here, let's load up, say, lttstore.com. Ooh, cable management and precision screwdrivers coming soon. Sign up for a notification. Anyway, I was going somewhere with this. That sort of traffic, page loads, small pictures, videos, is made up of a whole bunch of small-ish requests and resource files that are so small that they typically finish downloading before they even get up to gigabit speed. You can use the Network tab of your browser's dev tools to reveal what exactly is going on behind the scenes when you visit a web page. Just click through to review your timing details, and you can see exactly what's taking up time and potentially slowing down your experience. It turns out, a lot of the time, it's actually not the data transfer speed at all. Your ISP's default DNS needs to give you the IP address of a server before you can connect, and in many cases, this takes dozens of milliseconds, meaning that most of the time you spend waiting, that hyperfast connection was sitting idle anyway. Compounding the problem, you also need to wait for the remote server to process your request and begin the transfer. More idling. The good news is that switching to a public DNS provider like Cloudflare, OpenDNS, or Google can improve this performance. In fact, we did a whole video about it, and Gibson Research offers a DNS benchmark tool that can help determine the best option for your location. We're gonna have that link down below. The bad news is that everything I just said is free, and a fancier connection does nothing to improve it. Wait, bad news? That's not bad news, that's good news. I like free stuff. Oh wait, here's the bad news. What is this analytics and advertising? Okay, if a website is doing everything right, those resources should load after the content you actually care about, so they shouldn't impact your experience too much, if they're doing it right. In the real world though, ads and analytics can significantly impact your browsing speed. Services like browser-based ad blocking or a pie-hole DNS resolver on your local network, we actually made a whole video about that as well, we'll have that link down below, can eliminate at least some of those load times. But as someone who relies on web advertising for my livelihood and to pay my staff, how you guys doing?
Good.
Last paycheck clear?
Yep.
Good stuff. I would only ask that you consider the impact if you go that route. Now let's talk about your butts. But Linus! I like to download and share Linux ISOs. Well, first of all, your community spirit and commitment to open source is admirable, comrade. But you should really be looking into a seed box. For as little as $1 a month, you can get dedicated space and bandwidth on a server in a data center that has multiple high-speed internet connections, all away from the prying eyes of your internet service provider. Many of them even accept crypto as payment because, hey, you know how much they hate when people share Linux ISOs. But Linus, I want to run a web server at home. Okay? Again, why? Virtual private servers start even cheaper than seed boxes and have the same benefits, along with static IPs, easy backup options, and room to grow and scale if you need more capacity in the future. You also won't be risking your residential connection being terminated because you're technically violating your ISP's terms of service. You could even co-locate if you want dedicated hardware, with a Raspberry Pi costing under 10 bucks a month, which is probably less than that internet upgrade that you've been eyeing. But Linus, I'm a content creator and I need that sweet, sweet upload speed. All right, you've got me on that one. A proper fiber to the home ISP offers symmetric speeds. That is to say that the upload speed is the same as the download speed. And I'll be the first to admit that when you're uploading multiple 4K videos every week, that higher upload speed and not having to sit around and wait, it's pretty amazing. But watch out. Not all fiber services are equal, and many ISPs market their services as fiber because, I don't know, there's fiber somewhere. But that last mile connection from your home to the nearest node is actually DOCSIS 3 or 3.1, and your upload speeds tend to be much slower. Another thing to watch out for is that we've never seen YouTube ingest at multi-gig speeds, so you're probably still okay with a decent but not maxed out connection, which is especially true for Twitch. In that case, you only need about 8 megabits per 1080p60 stream. Though again, real-time streaming, I would build in some additional buffer. In that case, even like 4x if you don't want your audience to be like, yay, what happened? Bottom line, if you told 20-year-old Linus that he would one day be arguing against faster internet speeds, he would have laughed in your face. But things aren't getting any more affordable out there right now, guys. And if a reality check here can save even 1% of the people who watch this video, just $10 a month, that would work out to over $1 million saved a year, which is a pretty big win in my book. You know what else is in my book? This message from our sponsor.
Grammarly. Here at Linus Media Group, there's a lot of communication needed to get these videos out. Let me tell you, that's where Grammarly steps in. Grammarly is a secure AI partner that helps us write more clearly so we can move forward with our work faster. Getting your point across is essential when you're working on a tight deadline, so you can rely on Grammarly to help you paraphrase your sentences to be concise and more impactful, short amount of space. We're busy people. And Grammarly's app actions feature helps you keep your workflow in motion. No more toggling between tabs, just grab everything you need in one place. They've been around for 14 years now, that's nuts. So you know you can trust them when it comes to keeping your data private and secure. Sign up for an account and download for free using our link, grammarly.com/LTT03. If you wanna get access to extra features, get 20% off Grammarly Premium.
If you guys liked this, maybe you'd like to watch Dan and Sean trying to clean up the mess that Jake and I keep making of our network. Hey, Jake and I help.